When strangers are coming, they come to your house, they kill you all and say, "We're not killed, not killed." Where is your mind? Humanity cries. They think you are gods, but everyone dies. Don't swallow my soul, our souls.
Peter from PS Sound, and in this video we will have a bit more fun than in the previous one showing the Hondo around, because yeah, in that one I was just talking through the whole system, showing everything, how the system lays out. But in this one I will show the operation and we will play music. So yeah, I had to separate those videos because copyright is going to be a killer on this one, and I can only hope that some of you won't have issues watching it, because in some countries I have a suspicion that this video will be banned. That's the other danger of playing music, because yeah, copyrights on YouTube, not simple to deal with. Let's hop in and then I can show you what's happening in this car. Yeah, today is probably the last day I have these drivers in the car. I mean, those stag mids. Some people are asking what those were. Even if I explained it pretty well in the previous video, what drivers I have. Or someone asked, you know, Pete, what 18-inch driver do you have in the door? I was talking about that for several minutes. Sometimes I feel like, you know, what's the point to take any videos if people don't watch them? But the good thing is that probably 99% of you watch the videos in better detail. But yeah, this will be more fun, I promise. Here we go. So, system operation. What I really like in this HDSP5, other than the way it sounds, is that this can be turned on with the controller. You just press and hold the button, it comes on in like 6 seconds. And wherever you left it, whatever, well, probably was left on HD player, it starts to play in a second. So, it's... It's really, really simple to live with. There you go. And it plays. Someone was asking me why I have the file over there if I have the HD player as well. Then the thing is, this car was built in 2000 and, well, it was started in 2004. In 14, 8 years ago, and this car went through several versions. I changed so many things in it, and that player was put in 2016. So that was my main digital source, and I had this player, the X7 Mark 1, ever since. And it's been working absolutely fine. But then, of course, I built this custom dash for multimedia, so I can show videos as well, which opens up a whole new dimension. When we go to shows, you get to see a full video experience as if you were truly there. The band, right, is not just, you know, holographic, but you can literally see them through the video, and that's definitely an experience. It feels a bit more natural as well to sit with someone in the car next to each other, because when you don't play any video, you just listen to music, then SPR guys always have a laugh when they walk past the car on a meeting, and then they look through the windscreen and they're like, ah, two gay guys just looking out of their heads. And it's a bit like that. And some people feel also a bit intimidated, or they don't feel comfortable sitting so close to someone. It happened before that someone asked me to jump out of the car, and I you know, if I could just show the operation of the system and let him listen to music on his own, he felt more comfortable with that. But as soon as I play video, that's kind of gone. When you go to a cinema, someone sits next to you, you're not bothered, because your eyes are drawn to the screen. So the iPad streams to the HD Bluetooth module in the DSP. That one, the X7, is on coax wired, and then of course I have the HD player as well, so we have multiple options to play digital straight to the DSP. Yeah, premium sound system. Someone asked me in the previous video if all this upgrade is really that much better than that. I don't even answer that. Yeah, that's not used for anything. It's still functional, I don't use it. So let's play a few songs, and then I can show you how I normally demo the system to people, so I can also educate them about the importance of speaker locations, speakers with EQ, without EQ, things like that. Let's go back a few songs.
She's away. Ain't no sunshine when she's gone. She's always gone.
And that's actually my Boomy preset, because I just opened the presets. So you can have how many? 16 presets. I have quite a few there. Right? And then when you select 6, you can select maximum 6 from that list. Then the presets are placed on this page, and then between these you can easily recall any of them within a fraction of a second. So normally, actually, I start to play the system with only the wide bands, which are not playing wide bands in my full system tune, but it's nice to show what a pair of 4-inch drivers can play like with a bit of work. On this preset, I literally have 9 bands of EQ, and not even independent EQ for left and right, only for the pair, just quickly, you know, target the biggest problems and then sort the spectral balance out quickly. To be fair, they play crazy bass, considering They are only 4-inch driver. There you go. Now this is from the file. People could say, oh yeah, it's because you have huge enclosures on the dash, because originally these enclosures on the dash were designed for 6.5s and they are sealed. They are 12 and a half liter, fairly big, same size as my enclosure down there on the doors. So yes, we have a lot of air space, but at the same time, for a 4-inch, it's just way too large. It doesn't play much effect on it. Even if you had those mids just dropped into the dash stiffened up like we do it quite often, cutting a hole in the dash and dropping the driver in, they play just as low, even, let's call it free air, you know, without any restriction behind the driver, they play just as low. So that's not the reason why they play that low, it's just the fact that these drivers are pretty versatile. And to be fair, for the money, it's difficult to find another 4-inch driver that would play such a wide range. These are not supposed to be wide bands, but with a bit of work, they can measure and play up to 15k. I always say that measuring response is one thing, but how resolving it is on the top end is a different story. Yes, you can hear fine top end, and it's pretty convincing, and for some people, it might be absolutely fine, like let's say Jen Chapin, there you go.
I know, we're such a cliche. The lady tries to talk it through while the gentleman wants to wish it away. The floor is piled with wasted words, scorecards discarded for tresses on garden we couldn't keep track.
You know, well-recorded acoustic music can sound really nice, really natural, because it's very coherent. There's no integration between several speakers, and then you have to time them, you have to find the crossover slopes in phase with each other, and it's just, yeah, it's harder work to pull together a multi-speaker system. Whereas if you can keep it minimal, there's a beauty to it. Like one of the cars at the Eurofinals, at the EMMA Eurofinals, has three speakers, a pair of 6-inch Fostex widebands with, okay, fair enough, the guy makes his own amplifier, and those amps make a difference on the top end, big time. So two Y-bands and then a front sub, that's it. And with three speakers, he can do something like nobody else. Is it the best system on the planet? No, but at the same time, it has its magic. So Y-bands can be great, and we've built many cars with hybrid Y-bands, audible physics Y-bands, now some stag Y-bands as well. Micro Precision has a really nice Y-band, the 5 series mid-range Y-band. And yes, for some people it's absolutely fine. And I also show this preset to people how much mid-range matters. That plays most of your musical range, most octaves, so you should make sure that the mid-range is at the right location and is the right driver.
Oh, the hour, the silence here, the evening is ours.
But I also show to people what it's like. It's not EQ'd.
Then we won't talk anymore.
It's really boomy, boxy, no definition in the upper mid range and high frequency range. But if I switch.
You and me, we get it. We just let it
almost mid-range, up on the dash or at the bottom of the apula, due to corner loading and where you sit, they just have so much lower mid-range. And then people would think now on this preset where it's not EQ'd that, oh, it doesn't sound great, I don't want it, I don't like it. But then when I show it with the preset where they play, you know, with a bit of EQing, and they are like, bloody hell, it's so beautiful, I want it. Like, there you go, Dania Spear. People always ask me about this song, Dania Spear. It's Tuba Tiger Brag, and then track two, the trumpet song we always play. So that's without EQ. Then it's cleaned up. People hear this in the car with two speakers, then they are a bit stunned, like, what? Like, yeah, and it's not even a proper tune, as I said. 9 bands for the pair, that's it, and just time alignment, full range, no crossovers, and then they are surprised. Okay, fair enough, you know, the amplification and the hardware, the DSP behind it is, yeah, not something you find under the Christmas tree, or if you do, then yeah, you're lucky. But that Zapco AP amp with this HDSP5 with that DAC upgrade definitely does the trick. Plus, yes, it's playing from good source, from either the file or HD player. They both play nice. So, on to the next thing that I like to show to people. Of course, what the full system plays like, but also what the magic in this system is. So in the previous video I mentioned that I pulled the 6.5s out of the dash. I had to sell them to a customer. Finally I got my 4-inch Ecutones now, and those mid-ranges are proper reference level. They are so dynamic, so detailed, low distortion, just stunning. Having said that, knowing that they cost 5 times more than these Stags, are they really worth it? For most people, probably not, because when they hear this car with the current layout, with these tech speakers, they still say that, bloody hell Pete, this sounds so good. And 9 out of 10 people who sit in it, they always say it sounds so clean. And yes, it does, but it's not due to the mid-range, it's due to the tweeters. Because those Ecutones do something like no other tweeter can do, I've come across with yet, and I'm not the only one. People could talk to Marco and quite a few guys in Germany who have cars built with Ecutones, and when people hear it, they can tell straight away. For some people, it's too revealing, it's too clean, but at the same time, it doesn't add anything to the recording, it doesn't color it, it doesn't put a character on it. For some people, that's the character, that it's like, you know, this is definitely something I can't compare to anything else, so they say, okay, this has a character now. This is an Ecutone character. Whereas it's not. It's just the fact that it's just truly so transparent that it shows everything, what you put in. If the tune is not good enough, it will show it. If the recording quality is not good enough, it will show it. And then anything through your signal chain will be shown. But when you get it right, and you build a good system with a good equipment and you tune it well, then it's something else. It's definitely something else. So this is still the 4-inch.
Okay, let's go to the presets.
People, when the full system plays, it's a bit like they just hear too much detail. They're not used to it, to hear so much information from the recording, because most speakers are just not as revealing, and especially those who like a laid-back, mellow tune, because they like it stupidly loud without any harshness. But that's not realistic, and for them this is the opposite. Yeah, you always have to figure out what the customer wants, what their preference is, and that is always different from a reference level. They may have different reference level and very different preference. If they like a system more laid back, less revealing, then fair enough. You could even tune that out of these speakers, and yeah, it's doable. But where the magic with these speakers is how low distortion they are, and that comes kind of important when you want to tune a system in a very unconventional way when it comes to crossing over the tweeters. This is now a bit deep, and normally I don't talk about it, but I'm happy to share it now because this car is not going to the competitions anymore, and then those people who will ever sit in it, they will hear it and they will understand it. So, because these tweeters are so low distortion, you can cross them low. Not just a low crossover point, but a low, shallow slope as well. Most people go for a 24 dB slope because they can maintain a better phase summation between the mid-range and the tweeter, and that's just fine. But there's one trick I have learned ages ago. When you cross a tweeter at a 24 dB slope, you take so much information out of the system. Let's imagine a drum, okay? Let's find, actually, on the technical folder I have Jim Keltner. I say it slowly, Jim Keltner, but I will show the name as well. Come on. That's it. And it's one of the drum improvisation songs. Let's switch over to the coax input. Many people know this song. So, when you listen to a drum solo, especially at realistic loud levels, when the drummer hits the snare, the attack on the mid-range has to be present. It has to hit you in the face. Literally, some people's eyes go, you know, blinking because of the attack on the mid-range, if it's a good mid-range. Same is true for the tweeter. When the drummer hits the cymbal, let's say, or the ride, any of the... I will have to turn it up in a second, I just want to explain it. So, cymbals, that's where probably I have a sweet spot for systems. So the cymbal is part of the drum set which plays way, way lower than most people think. Most people think that the cymbals on the drum set only do the splash on the top end. It just makes a nice, clean, top-endy splash. But no. Especially if you look at the ride on the drum set, which is the largest cymbal on the drum set, that can play really low, down to like easily like 500 hertz or even lower. That's how you can determine how big the size of that instrument is, whether it's the hi-hat or whether it's the, you know, any other. But ride is the best example because that's always the largest, and in, especially in jazz music, they play a lot on it. And when you cut a tweeter with a 24 dB slope, let's say with a conventional crossover point, just let's say, okay, 4K, let's say. When people think about the upper harmonics of instruments, the same is also true for the lower harmonics. So when that cymbal is hit, and then you cross it with a steep slope, all that information is cut off from the lower octaves. And then you think, Pete, but why is it a problem? Because then we have the mid-range playing the rest. Oh yeah, but finding a mid-range that will keep up with the tweeter's speed and accuracy and transient response is not that simple, because that tweeter has like 0.3 gram of moving mass, and that mid-range has, I don't know, 3, 4, 5 gram. So there's a huge difference between those two drivers where you cross them over, and you expect the mid-range to play that frequency range close to the acoustical crossover slope exactly the same. How could it play the same as the tweeter? It just won't. You may measure, you know, a good summation and a linear response around the acoustical crossover point, but they will sound very different. The timbre of the speaker is just changed. So yes, it's good to find a mid-range that's very similar to the tweeter. Then you have a better chance to get it right. However, this tweeter can do some crazy shit. So, okay. So this is now the tweeter. 4K, 24 dB, right? You only hear the very, very fine top end, nothing else, right? So, the song is on a repeat. It's gonna start again. Listen to the snare when it comes in. And the toms. You hardly hear anything from them. And of course, yeah, the mid-range would play it. But this tweeter can do this. Just a tweeter playing, and even on my crazy boomy mad preset, they play like that with a low shallow crossover point. And yes, there's a fair amount of overlap between the tweeter and the mid-range this way, and many people say, oh no, that's a no, that's difficult to get it right. It is, of course it's difficult to get it right, but it's doable. Go to home hi-fi. How many speakers are designed with shallow slopes? Loads. Yes, that's a very different environment, and it's even more challenging here in the car. But when you find a tweeter that can do this, then everything becomes so transparent, so realistic and detailed. And you can go loud, trust me. I'm sure many people will comment down in the comment section who have sat in this car, and if someone told me that it's not loud enough, then they have hearing problems. Because most people usually start to back off, they start to lean back in the seat if I go crazy, as they finally just too much level coming from the front stage without any distortion, and they are well surprised because they don't expect it. Okay, the tweeters are not insensitive, they are pretty sensitive, like 93 dB, so they don't take much power. You know, you turn the volume up a bit and then you are way above 100 dB straight away, and that's loud. And then I think the highest I measured in this car was 120. I don't want to say anything duff, but it was above 120 dB with the front end. Not the sub level, because with sub, this car can do 140s. But with the front end, I was way above 120, and that's seriously crazily stupid loud. Yeah, I try not to do that too often because I just screw up my ears, and they are very important. So, yeah. Let's find something, yes. Steal the tweeters. All the strings. You hear all the strings in full body. You even hear the kick drum. If I put it back to a conventional crossover point, the steep slope. Yeah. Or wideband. Yeah, you don't have such a refined top end anymore with
Abraham.
Them.
Labolier.
Of course, they play low.
And I am truly very happy to share moments with all of you. I hope you have as much fun and as much joy as we did.
And then the full system. Of course, it's still a phone recording, so take it as you want it, but at least it gives you a bit more depth about all the madness that happens in sound quality in cars, and why I'm doing this, why I share so much footage with you guys, and even more on Patreon, because that's, you know, I don't know everything. I still have so much to learn. I'm still 30, turning 36 very soon. It's kind of frightening to know where I'm going to be in 10-20 years time, how much I will discover and how much I can learn from more experienced people. But at the same time, it's also beautiful that I've been one of the lucky ones who managed to get into the circles to try Ekiton speakers first. These were not even, you know, that wasn't even Ekiton Automotive. That only came 2020 February, and I had the first production line three-way set for the Insignia. Before that, I was using the Arco kind of prototype drivers. We had the first Ekiton front sub in UK, not necessarily worldwide, because Marco in Germany already used those subs, but most people didn't even know anything about those front subs from Ekiton. Well, front subs, those subs, we use them for front subs. And to be fair, that's what they are the best for. I wouldn't use them as rear subs, especially for systems where you want to go crazy loud, or you would need two or three of them, because they don't have high excursion, but they are super accurate. Whatever Ekiton makes is just accurate. Maybe that's what the name is coming from, Ekiton. Come on.
Oh.
Warren Bands. Stage depth just decreases so much. Becomes narrower as well. This recording has a lot of detail on the top end as well. Oh, what is it? Chantal, Margot. Yeah, you can see it. Yeah, we could go into the detail what the mid bass is doing in this car, but to be fair, that doesn't have such a big role. And when I tell to people that it's still not the best mid bass option, it's the best I could get out of this car and in the system. Sadly, we can't do true IB in this car. If only I had bought a car 8 years ago with the mindset I have now, then I would have chosen a car which has the space for true IB mid-bass, then that would be beautiful. Like in the Suzuki, my wife's car, that is stupid. That's the best mid-bass we've ever built. It's ridiculous. Still, these eights can do something special and it surprises people. So, you know, let's say we have a preset for the best accuracy and still everything is locked to the top of the dash, but I can also change the preset and then have a bit of madness. Then of course these are not 6.5s, these are 8s, and I have loads of power behind them with a lot of control, then they can truly kick. And I also needed them because I have 218s in the back in true IB, and the 18s need proper up front bass. You can't cross the rear true IB subs high. You can't cross them at like 60, 70, 80 hertz. No chance. Maybe I have to have a separate video about talking and comparing true IB to trunk IB. It will happen. But yeah, in this car, I need solid up front bass. That's empty. I don't have front sub there, as explained in the previous video. There was a time when I had it. By integrating a front sub on that side to a 6.5 mid bass I used to have, to that side was easy. By integrating that front sub to this side was damn hard, especially from competition. I realized I needed stereo kick bass up front. That's why I have an enclosure on each side. So yeah, those Accuton 8s, custom 8s, work really well. I can do a lot with them, and they keep up with the 18s at the back. The 18s are crazy, especially when I take the demos to the absolute mad levels, when whether you play a good drum solo or you play a mental hip-hop song or drum and bass, or anything with infra range, then it just opens up people's mind what can be done. And how fast they are, just so fast they keep up with the music. They are not sluggish. That's the beauty of acoustic elegance. They are light, sensitive. Jeez, I just talk. Sometimes I just talk about so much rubbish, right? So, let's see the iPad. Actually, I've got to check if it's connected. Bluetooth. Hopefully my phone is not connected, because then it won't allow me. Hang on, yeah, my phone is currently connected to it, and I can't. Oh, okay, I have to break this video. So I have to break the video, disconnect the Bluetooth on my phone, because it cannot connect to devices simultaneously. Well, it can, actually it can, but not this way. So here we go, now it's connected, simple as that. Go back to Tidal, then we switch over to coax, optical, and then Satcom is the Bluetooth. That COM port is for streaming. And then it just changes everything, because then you get to see image 2. Sense when you sit in here, and then when it's also dark, when all the windows are blacked out. If only I had the remote to the lighting in the workshop, then I could just switch it off, but that's not the case now. But then yeah, the screen just sucks you in, it takes you away completely. When you have a system where the tuning is at a level that the hardware disappears, your ears are not pulling towards the speakers because it's so balanced and the staging is so solid, the image is rock solid, then you already lose the fact where the sound comes from, other than if something is panned in the recording far left or far right, then you can tell it's coming from there or there, or you can pinpoint everything in front of you, but you are not focusing on the driver that, oh, everything is coming from there. So when you have a solid image and the screen is also in line with it, then it's truly like you have a speaker there and she's singing to you. And it's not just as if, it's like real. She is singing to you. It's freaky.
To be the act, to be the hour, to be the light, to be the way, to be the sin, to find the time, to make it right, to make it matter.
Stuck in the video and I just want to sit here. That's the sad part of this car now, that I don't drive it daily, and yeah, I miss it. New car has to be introduced, and we need a system in that ASAP, because it is difficult. Once you get used to something like this, then you really want it. So that's where the Honda is after so many years, and hopefully I can keep it at the workshop for a good while. I can take it to local meetings or anyone who books an appointment, then you know, you're welcome to listen to it, and then I can go through everything with you. Just a bit of this.
I'm calling you up to get down, down. Show me a piece of your heart. I'm calling you up to get down, down. Show me a piece of your heart, a piece of your life. I'm calling you up to get down, down, down. The way that we touch is never enough. I'm turning you up to get down, down. Show me a piece of your heart, a piece of your life. I'm calling you up to get down, down, down. The way that we touch is never enough. I'm turning you up to get down, down, down. What, sorry, just quickly, what if it's da 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 down, down, down. Da 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 da.
This is where the Honda is. I may have an update next when I have the Ekuton mids in, and then you will possibly see more content of that on Patreon, comparing this mid-range to the Ekuton. So that will have more content over there. But yeah, hopefully you liked what you've seen and you could follow all the things I've shown. I know it's a phone recording, so please don't take it as a reference. It's just to share inspiration, pretty much. If it sounds nice through the recording, happy days. It inspires you even more to get your system properly tuned and built, because it's all for love of music, isn't it?
Da da da. A da da da, a da da da, a down down down. A da da da, a da da da, a da da da, a down down down. A da da da, a da da da, a da da da, a down down down. Show me an easy, show me the hardy. I'll be what you want.
Another thing I may have to mention about this DSP. This is the first DSP that doesn't have lag through Bluetooth streaming. I wasn't able to play videos with the previous Helix DSP I had in the car because it has such delay that the lip sync was off. Even if it's just like half a second, it really throws you off. You can't enjoy videos because the sound and the image is just not in time, and it's annoying. It's very annoying. And like here as well, if the fingers are not in time the way he blows that saxophone, then saxophone, trumpet, I can't even talk. So let's call it the end, guys. You know the usual things. Feel free to share it, comment on it, subscribe to the channel if you are not subscribed yet. You find all the links in description to Patreon, to the playlist of this car, to links to our socials. Check that out. And yeah, hopefully I can meet many of you in the future and I can bring more videos to you. So this is it for this one. I'll see you in the next. Take care.